Good morning, Western North Carolina. This is WebTechXR, my alias, WebTechXR, Mark Zarnecki. I am here with Dr. William A. Sederburg. Bill is how I will reference him. Bill is going to discuss the amazing progress for broadband in Western North Carolina. And we'll start off, Bill, if you can introduce yourself.
Thank you, Mark. My name is Bill Sederburg. I'm a retired college president here in Asheville, North Carolina. And for the last 5 years, I've been involved in a group called WNCBroadband.org, which has been one of the leaders advocating for broadband for Western North Carolina. And it's just an exciting time in broadband-related issues. I think that 2021 and the start of 2022 are going to go down as just absolutely amazing time in which the country got serious about providing broadband connectivity throughout the entire country. Congress finally got around to passing two pieces of legislation, one the infrastructure bill, which will ultimately provide about $1 billion of funds for North Carolina to extend broadband. And then the state legislature finalized their state budget, which reallocated some of the previous federal money plus some of their own state money and put another $1 billion into the broadband bucket. So in the last 3 months or so, there has been about $2 billion that has been appropriated for broadband coming to North Carolina. And if you kind of extrapolate what our share would be here in the western part of the state, we would probably get around $140 to $160 million that will start to become available in 2022 to help build out the infrastructure, provide financial assistance to low-income individuals, as well as help with the training of people to use the internet successfully in dealing with health issues or education issues or business related issues. And so it's just an exciting time related to broadband, and it's been really a lot of fun to be part of it.
Nice. Certainly very amazing. And when we say the word amazing, we can also say some amazing things happened in regards to politics. What comments do you have on that?
Well, amazing is the right word in my mind, just because we've seen such a bitter divide between Republicans and Democrats over the last 4 years, 5 years, in which very little seems to be getting done in Washington, D.C., and the partisan bickering is rather intense. Well, broadband is an issue that was seen as a need by both Republicans and Democrats, and it has unified both parties, and congressmen and state legislators have joined forces to provide broadband money for the state of North Carolina and ultimately here for Western North Carolina. And so as we think of politics and being the dysfunctional time that we live in, it's just amazing that broadband was an issue that both parties recognized. Both parties said, let's put some dollars into it and let's see if we can really move the country ahead in providing connectivity, high-speed connectivity to the internet for all of our citizens. And so amazing, I think maybe we're overusing a little bit, but it's a rewarding experience anyway to see both parties coming together and doing something good for society.
Okay, very good. There's going to be a significant amount of money coming. How do you see that being invested?
Well, we're going to get a significant amount, as you mentioned, but there's a lot of work that has to be done prior to those funds being available and applied, and there's construction projects underway. One thing that needs to be done is the completion of better mapping throughout the country so that these funds will be used in areas that are currently not provided broadband services. And the FCC has been charged with that responsibility, is to redo their mapping and provide a accurate set of maps nationally that can be used. So that's one item that needs to be done. We also need to have better coordination of the laws and regulations between the federal government and the state governments. And that will take a little bit of time to work out. So you got three or four federal agencies that are involved, and you got at least two state agencies that are involved that need to kind of have one set of regulations and rules related to how these funds are going to be distributed. So that's going to slow things down a little bit. And then you'll have a bidding process, and you'll have a distribution process. So as we think this through, it's likely to be towards the end of 2022 before you start to see that yellow fiber being laid throughout the countryside and a major improvement made. Now, countering and hampering some of that development is the fact that we have a labor shortage and we have a desperate need for people trained in these fiber technologies and in telecommunication strategies. And so we need to amp up or increase the number of people that are able to work on these projects. And secondly, there is such a demand worldwide for fiber cable that we see a shortage of fiber cable being manufactured. And we're probably going to be, because North Carolina did not get in early and get their orders in for fiber, we're probably going to be at the tail end of those orders. So labor shortage, fiber availability, regulations and kind of consolidation of that, and then the normal bidding process. So we're looking at probably the end of 2022 and maybe into 2023 before we really start to see significant physical progress.
In regards to low-income citizens, what thoughts or comments do you have on funds becoming available?
As we look at the issues related to broadband, they really fall into three categories. The first category is connectivity, and that's kind of the hardwire, the infrastructure, and that most of these dollars are being used to build out the delivery system of the internet. The second set of issues has to do with affordability. So it's one thing to have high-speed fiber out running down your street, but if you can't afford to pay for your monthly fee to access the internet, that's not very helpful to you. So the affordability issue is a big one, and the federal government helped with that. They expanded and extended grants, monthly grants of, I think, $30 a month to help low-income citizens finance internet connectivity. That's a little bit less per month than was allocated before, but it's broader and more people will be eligible. So I think you're going to see here in Western North Carolina, nonprofit organizations and others pushing this grant program so that more citizens can afford to access the internet. The third set of issues has to do with usage. And that is one thing to have the internet there. It's one thing to bring it into your home and have it available. But you also need to know how to use it. And you need to know how to connect with your medical providers and the hospitals. And you need to connect to the schools. And you're going to see organizations, I think, stepping up to the plate and foundations to assist individuals learn how to use the internet effectively, how to Zoom, how to, you know, connect to their healthcare provider. And that's going to probably zero in on a lot of senior citizens or individuals that have not been technologically sophisticated up to this date. So those three categories of issues, I think, will be dominant here in Western North Carolina over the coming months.
When we talk about infrastructure, we also talk about something called the middle mile and the infrastructure funding for Native American reservations and a local provider here. What thoughts or comments do you have on the topic of middle mile?
Well, I always kind of chuckle when I have a question or think about middle mile, because I would have known nothing about this 4 or 5 years ago. I mean, this is just out of my realm of thinking about it. But I've learned about all this since then. So, for example, after the last recession in 2008, there's a lot of stimulus money that was spent. And in North Carolina, a huge amount of that stimulus money at the state level was spent in building out an internet infrastructure connecting all the universities and all the schools in the state in a very sophisticated high-speed network throughout the entire state. Now, that doesn't really help the library down the street if they're not part of that network. And so the middle mile language is, how do you run fiber from the extended network that connects all of the universities and all the K-12 schools. So how do you run fiber from that network to the library? And that's where middle mile gets referred to. And in North Carolina, we have a great organization called ERC Broadband, which provides middle mile services for nonprofit organizations, educational organizations, and governmental units to help them connect into the core of the internet network. So that's middle mile, and there's some federal money that's been set aside for middle mile expansion, and we're hopeful that we'll get some of those dollars here to help build out the middle mile network. And ERC Broadband, interestingly, has a very extensive middle mile network throughout Western North Carolina. And they can, of course, speak for themselves about that, but it's fascinating what they do. The second category that's in the federal bill that's kind of similar is the dollars for the Native American reservations. And there's a fair amount of money that's set aside for the reservations. Now, this is unclear to me to what extent the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indians will want to apply for and utilize, because they've actually done a very nice job on the reservation of connecting their residents, and they may not either be eligible for these dollars nor need these dollars as much as other Native American tribes. So we will see how that plays out, but it can be very helpful to these Native American communities over the coming months. So those two pots of money aren't talked a lot about when we talk about broadband, but I think might be quite significant.
Nice. And when we talk about infrastructure and internet connectivity being future-proof, what thoughts or comments do you have in regards to internet speeds?
The word future-proof is a fascinating one, and that I don't think we're ever going to be future-proof for anything. But the word in the broadband world is that the speed and the needed speed of internet connectivity is increasing so dramatically. And there's, if you're familiar, of course, with the technology of Moore's Law, which means the speed of computers doubles every 18 months. And the needs of faster and faster speeds double every 18 months or so. And so I chuckle. So I was at a conference, and a speaker from the state came in and talked about there is no need for broadband because most citizens could already access 3 megabits per second. And how much faster could you possibly need than 3 megabits per second? Well, if you know anything about broadband, that doesn't do anything. We couldn't have this Zoom conversation. We couldn't really do much of anything at 3 megabits per second. And so an interesting aspect of this legislation is it set a new standard for the federal government and really the entire country as 100 megabits per second download speed, and saying that that is the new definition of high-speed internet connectivity. The old definition by the FCC was 25 megabits per second download speed. So this is a significant leveraging up of the speed requirements. And the most logical, easiest way to provide 100 megabit speed is through fiber cable. And so when people talk about future-proofing, fiber is the technology that can be used to go from 100 to 1,000 or 1 gigabits per second without any kind of problem whatsoever, whereas your old cable TV companies have to redo all of their technologies and have to restructure what they do. But fiber, if fiber is in the ground and coming to your home, you're going to be able to go to 1 gigabit speeds or higher. And that's what's referred to as future-proofing the broadband network. So we're making progress on that. But it is interesting how you continually hear people not understand that 25 megabits per second is no longer adequate. You need to go to 100, or you need to go, I think here in this area, you can easily get 300 megabits per second. That's the Charter offering is one, and there are others that offer at least that. And our new standard will be in a few years will be 1 gig or 1,000 gigabits per second. Connectivity. So when we talk about future proofing, it's really to set up the fiber backbone of the region. And I might add another thing I learned, which I didn't think I'd either know about or care about, was that people will say, well, what about 5G and what about the technology related to wireless telephones or cell phone coverage? Well, the backbone of the cell phone coverage towers is a fiber network. And so you can only operate a 5G system if you have a robust underlying structure of fiber throughout your community. And so future-proofing really refers to using fiber cable and getting fiber cable laid throughout the entire country.
So federal and state legislation also provides dollars for the state of North Carolina, and the state of North Carolina has NCBIO and the state's Broadband and Digital Equity Office. What comments do you have on these state resources?
Well, it's been pretty fascinating that North Carolina has been a leader in this at the state level. We were one of the first states to create a state office called the Broadband Infrastructure Office, BIO. And that's been in existence 5 or 6 years and was one of the first states offices like that to be created. And currently there are only 26 states that have similar offices that are responsible for broadband. Now, the reason for that is that broadband has always been defined as a private good, not a public utility. And so states did not feel compelled to create offices to handle broadband related issues. But with the federal money coming down, you're seeing state after state creating a state office to manage the federal grants and manage state dollars to help do the mapping of where broadband is needed, to help distribute the dollars and monitor the distribution of those dollars, and to help with these other issues that we talked about, affordability and education. So you're starting to see offices such as the BIO office in North Carolina, and recently Governor Cooper reshuffled the cards a little bit and elevated it further and created the Office of Digital Equity and Inclusion that has the BIO office within it. And so you see Governor Cooper, and really with the support of the state legislature, making it somewhat of a priority here in North Carolina, and that has been very helpful. My home state where I spent most of my life was Michigan, and Michigan just this last year created a broadband office, and I've been in communication with folks in Michigan about that, and they're kind of scrambling to get caught up. I use that word scrambling to get caught up with what North Carolina had done. So we are in a better position at the state level with expertise and with experience related to broadband that probably is better than a number of other states.
So about 5 years ago, the foundation was set for this amazing progress for broadband in Western North Carolina. Can you tell us a little bit about the history of the evolution?
Yeah, I can talk a lot about that. As you get older, you can talk more about history than anything else. Talk about the future, it's pretty limited, but talk about history. I got that. About 5 years ago, a number of us, there's a leadership group called the Hub, which was made up of leaders in the Buncombe County area. And a guy by Jack Cecil, who's president of Biltmore Farms, was one of the leaders of the Hub. And Jack asked me, and other Hub members asked me, to help coordinate an effort to investigate what could be done related to broadband. And we started a committee made up of local cities to recruit a company to come into Western North Carolina and provide high-speed gigabit service for the entire area. And then we narrowed it down to five cities that were along the broadband network that we had talked about had been connecting the universities. And we went out and put out a proposal, and we got two companies that came forward and said they were interested in working with us. At the end of the day, we were not successful with it because the national trends had changed, and Google and AT&T and these other big providers were no longer trying to do community-wide projects. They were more interested in specific neighborhoods or sub-projects. And so that project we called West Next Generation Network. And we had five cities that worked together. And at the end of the day, we weren't particularly successful. Although we did recruit River Street as a provider that had increased interest in helping us in Western North Carolina. Hotwire was another one. There's other firms that we dealt with, but we were not successful to the degree we would have liked. That ultimately then was given to the Land of Sky Regional Planning Commission, and Sarah Nichols, who works with Land of Sky, is the leader of that effort. And the cities and counties continue to work together with Land of Sky, and they've received a number of grants to do planning, to do training, to help with the schools. And we're very proud of what Land of Sky has done with the West Next Generation Network project. But because we shifted that over to Land of Sky, we then created the WNCBroadband.org project, which is in partnership with UNC Asheville. And we use UNCA students to help us do policy papers, to help us do videos. And we have a class this winter that's going to be doing a set of videos and multimedia conversations with the public about broadband and the needs here in the Asheville area. So that's what we're currently working on, is WNCBroadband.org. And it's been a fun project. We have no particular structure to it, other than the partnership with UNC Asheville. And the chancellor there, Nancy Cable, has been phenomenally supportive. And they are hosting every year a leadership summit related to broadband. And we're busy putting that together for 2022, in which in the past we've had over 100 individuals get together. And these are the county commissioners and legislators and mayors and others to talk about broadband. And I think this year there'll be a lot of interest again because of the money that's now available. So that's just a little bit about the history. We've involved a lot of interesting people. Just a few of them jump to mind. One is a gentleman by the name of Stag Newman. Stag was the chief technologist at the FCC and was one of the co-authors of President Obama's broadband plan. And he knows more about technology than anybody that I know of. And Stag constantly reminds me that we're really swimming against the current in Western North Carolina because the mountain cost of laying fiber is so much higher than fiber being laid in Eastern North Carolina or elsewhere. So the money that's being given out will go less far here than it will in other parts of the state. So Stag is one person. We also have Greg Vogt, who was a former FCC attorney, and he's lent his hand to this project. We have a national consultant by the name of Doug Dawson, who's very prominent in this issue. He lives in Asheville. We have a number of people that have retired here or are willing to donate their time for broadband here in the region. So part of our task is to get these people engaged and involved in supporting broadband.
So as we wrap up, it is a lot of incredible dialogue about amazing funding coming. Are we going to see immediate results, or what comments do you have on next steps?
Well, I think the most immediate result, we're going to start to see immediate results, but one issue that we're still waiting some guidance from the state on is the Buncombe County has set aside $4.4 million of federal relief money for broadband expansion. They've had a committee working on that for the past year. They have put out an RFP to recruit a provider to help fill in the gaps here in Buncombe County, which in the unserved areas. But as I mentioned before, there is a need to figure out all the regulations and make all these different programs work together. So they are awaiting, I believe, the approval from the state to expend the dollars for their project. And the reason why that's an issue is the state legislature has wanted to protect the private internet service providers, and they prohibited counties from being too aggressive in providing broadband directly. And so the state needs to sign off on what Buncombe County wants to do. So, but once they do that, and that could come almost any time, once they do that, then they are ready to go. So that will be an immediate win. Then we have, of course, some of the money that's going to start flowing is for the helping the needy and helping educate people, and grants to nonprofit organizations. And that will be faster than getting fiber and getting trenches dug and stuff like that. And so that will be more immediate. And we're working with the Dogwood Health Trust that have been very supportive of doing some of this training and working with the nonprofits and educating people about broadband. And so I think you're going to see some fairly aggressive actions in the next few weeks, really. For one thing, I think you're going to be hearing an announcement of state money that will be spent for local communities to do inclusiveness plans of how they're going to help low-income areas and low-income individuals and underserved people and underserved populations with broadband. So you're going to see that happen fairly quickly.
Okay, and as we come to closure here, if you had a magic wand, what would you cast with your magic wand in regards to broadband, and closing comment on how to communicate with the Western North Carolina Broadband Project?
Well, I had a magic wand. I'd take all this money and send it to me personally, but that probably isn't really in the running here. So if you limit the magic wand business to broadband in this world, I would like the counties and the cities to be given more flexibility in doing their mapping of where areas are that aren't being adequately served. I would like to have then more money going to expertise so that the counties and the cities and the regional planning commissions could hire people to really work on this project. Because it's been a private good and not a public good, local government doesn't have expertise on this, and that is missing in this whole mixture. So I would encourage that. I would also encourage the money to be distributed with a formula change that recognizes the higher cost of laying fiber here in Western North Carolina compared to other parts of the state. I would also streamline the grant process, and so it wouldn't be as cumbersome, and that it wouldn't require quite as much matching. Some of these programs require a certain amount of match dollars from the internet service provider or other sources such as foundations, et cetera. And I would lower those match requirements. And then I would also really emphasize the need for better planning throughout a region. And we right now, the internet service providers don't need to tell you where they have fiber laid. They don't need to tell you where their service area is. And I think that if I totally had that magic wand, I would require them to provide on a confidential basis that kind of information to the state and to local government so that we could be more direct and rational about the process.
Okay, and if there is somebody that wants to help with the advocacy of broadband in Western North Carolina, what is the preferred communication for you?
Well, I think the easiest thing, of course, this all relies on having internet. It's always funny to me that we always talk to each other, people that have high-speed internet. We talk about these issues and totally missing those people that don't have any access. But WNCBroadband.org would be the connecting point on the web, and my email is on there, and Mark Zarnecki's email is on there, and other leaders of this project, Dr. Mark Wes, who's the head of the part of the political science department at UNC Asheville, is our liaison with UNC Asheville, is on there. One way to communicate with us is through WNCBroadband.org. We're also available in other means. But we really, at this point, probably don't need thousands of volunteers. But in 6 months, I think we will need, because that's when things start to really happen, and we'll need people to be what are called digital navigators to help people navigate through this digital world. We'll need a more coordinated effort and volunteers to help with the mapping and different items. So we should have some opportunities for people to be engaged in the future.